At first, the cancellation of the Brady Bunch came as a relief for cast members who were tired of their Goody Two Shoes characters. But while some found other acting jobs right away, most had trouble shedding their Brady image. The transition wouldn't get any easier as new generations of kids fell in love with the series.
I think at that time they figured 5 years, that was a long run. Little did they know we'd be coming back.
The Brady Bunch was never a favourite of the critics, and the sitcom was seen as a joke within the entertainment industry. Christopher Knight and Susan Olsen experienced the ridicule firsthand.
Being a former Brady and trying to do anything in the industry was extremely uncool. And there was not really any respect for us. It's like, oh yeah, you were on that stupid Saccharine Sweet show. And it's like, well, I didn't write the scripts.
If you're not respected and you're a Brady, you become a real easy mark. You got a target the size of Nebraska on your back.
The backlash was also humbling for 19-year-old Barry Williams. The role of Greg Brady had made him one of the biggest teen idols of the early 1970s. And he thought the whole world wanted his services.
I had attitude about it. Somebody very innocently might say, gee, Barry Williams might be right for this role in this movie. We'd like him to come in and audition or come in and interview or read. And I might come back with, hey, if you want to see what I do, turn on the TV.
That attitude, needless to say, went down really well with Hollywood casting directors.
All the time that I joined, started in the business from the time I was about 10 until 20, it had all been one straight rise. So why then at 20 should it take a nosedive? And when it did, it is extremely humbling and it is extremely difficult to adjust to.
Eve Plum was the only Brady who was able to shake the typecasting problems which plagued her co-stars. Months after her high school graduation in 1976, Plum scored a plum role in a controversial television movie.
I think every actor wants to play somebody who's bad, you know, somebody who's doing the bad thing. So I got to play a teen prostitute, and of course I was so naive.
You won't forget me. You'll come for me.
Anytime you need me.
But I need you now.
Plum received glowing reviews for her portrayal of Dawn, but similar roles dried up as The Brady Bunch became a hit in syndication. By 1976, the sitcom aired every afternoon on television stations across the country, as well as abroad, as we all know.
Probably one of the reasons it appeals so broadly to kids, I guess, is with six kids in the family, there is probably a Brady child that every child identified with. If you kind of wanted to be the pretty girl in high school, you could aspire to be Marcia Brady. If you were the middle sibling who kind of got overlooked, you probably sympathised with Jan Brady. You know, there were little girls like Cindy Brady. You know, the boys were exactly the same.
Even though millions of kids identified with the Bradys, it didn't translate into millions of dollars for them. The actors received a pittance when the Brady Bunch began its highly successful syndication run.
As I look back, they got us for so little. And then the residual contracts were not very good. So Paramount Studios has made so much money off of that show.
Frustrated at the situation, Florence Henderson, Maureen McCormack, Susan Olsen and Mike Lookinland decided if they couldn't cash in on the Brady show, they would cash in on the Brady name. So, in the spring of 1976, they resurrected their Brady Bunch characters during a guest appearance on the popular Don and Marie
show. Why do you have time for a cold drink?
What do you have?
I have an assortment. Oh, any kind of milk you want. Any kind.
I don't want any milk.
Me neither.
It's funny because as uncool as I thought that would be, or as uncool as I knew it would be, I really, really wanted to do the show because I wanted to work with these people again. I wanted to work.
Yes, Greg left us and moved to Milwaukee.
He's gone to college?
No, he's trying to get a date with Laverne and Shirley.
We've been trying to find a teenage boy to replace him.
And we had to have someone wholesome enough to fit our image.
That episode of the Donnie and Marie show rated through the roof, prompting the phone call from then ABC Network Supremo Michael Eisner to show producer Marty Croft.
He called me up one day and he said, hey, he said, how would you guys like to leave the Donnie and Marie show and do something really, you know, do something really special. And I said, well, what's that? He said, well, how would you like to do a variety hour with the Brady Bunch?
Michael Eisner isn't the kind of guy you say no to. So in the summer of 1976, Croft went to work on the Brady Bunch variety hour. Putting the cast back together was his first hurdle.
He promised me everything but the moon. I was the one with the talent. I was the one they were going to feature. It was Florence and me the whole way. And I was going to have a solo song every week, and the skits were going to be around me, and I'd have the best costumes and the biggest dressing room and the most money.
I remember that negotiation. It's like, I don't sing. Well, we want you to come back down the list. You'll just do the wraparounds and the front and the end. And you only have to do two numbers in group at the front and the back. And we'll just have you doing a lot of the skits and the comedy stuff.
Croft was a persuasive bloke. 8 of the original cast members signed up, including Robert Reed, a big surprise because of his intense hatred for his Brady Bunch role. Reed was excited about the opportunity to sing and dance. Eve Plum was the lone party pooper.
I'm not really sure why the decision was made to say no, other than I remember it was a very emphatic no thank you, and we're doing other things now, and it really doesn't, you know, because everybody always wants it, you know, come on, do one for the team, you know, it'll be fun, let's get everybody back together, and, you know, why, you know, be a team, and that doesn't seem to be the argument that's going to get me there.
Unable to sign Plum, Croft improvised by replacing her with a lookalike named Jerry Reichel. Reichel, who's referred to by fans as Fake Jan, joined the cast for rehearsals in the fall of 1976. The Brady Bunch Variety Hour featured a mixture of musical numbers and comedy sketches, new territory for everyone, except Florence Henderson, who started her career as a singer on Broadway.
It was very tough. They had never done this. We were trying to, you know, show them in their best light, so it was a lot of hard work to make this show happen.
For weeks, the cast worked 16-hour days in preparation for the show's premiere on Sunday, November 28, 1976. They needed to.
Baby face, I'm up in heaven when I'm in your fond embrace. I didn't need a show, 'cause I just fell in love with your pretty baby. You've got the cutest little baby face. You've got the cutest little.
I loved variety television, but it was, usually you have very trained variety performers, and the kids weren't. Barry was on his way then.
You've got the cutest little baby face. You've got...
Greg, not yet.
Music is my life.
Even Bob wasn't very musical. He wanted to be musical more than anything, and he had 2 left feet.
Look, what I really am is an architect. And my family wanted this variety show. You know, it was their idea. I didn't want to do it. But, I love my family.
Robert Reed worked the hardest, you know. He had trouble dancing, walking in rhythm, so he had trouble dancing in rhythm. But Robert Reed worked harder than anybody.
It's going to be okay, honey. Just follow me and hurry.
The complete lack of musical talent didn't seem to bother viewers, who were anxious to see how the Brady kids had grown up. The Variety Hour was the evening's highest rating television show. Croft was immediately ordered to turn it into a weekly series. The show was retitled The Brady Bunch Hour and returned to the air 2 months later in January 1977. Guest stars included such big names as Tina Turner, Charo, and Supercouple, Farrah Fawcett and Lee Majors.
Mr. McBride, I'd like you to meet Mr. and Mrs. Majors.
Oh.
As the world knows, he is the $6 million man, and she is, of course, one of Charlie's angels.
Yes, Mr. Merrill, we have seen them.
The Bradys are on TV, too, and they're only on once a month, but, well, they're decent people.
But audiences were less interested in the Brady Bunch Hour the second time around. I wonder why. It sank in the ratings after the first airing.
I don't think it flew because I don't think there was a public there willing to embrace the Bradys as performers and singers. And as we've talked about, there were varying degrees of ability here.
It was a little embarrassing. I was never a fan of disco music, and here we were doing all these disco songs and such, and I didn't think it was a great show, but I was really eager to do it because I like to work.
It luckily didn't last for me too long, or I would have probably killed myself.
It's not working, and I'm very, very sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
No, it isn't. You see, you don't want to do it, and I don't want to see it.
In May of 1977, after eight shows, the plug was pulled on the Brady Bunch Hour. It was a mercy killing and a great relief to the cast, who were hugely embarrassed by the show. And it was extremely good news for Sherwood Schwartz, who had opposed the Variety Hour from the start.
It didn't make any sense for this nice family that has family problems suddenly doing variety. It didn't make any sense. I thought it was ridiculous. It was just ridiculous.
Despite being left out of the creation and production of the Variety Hour, Schwartz didn't let the show's failure sour his feelings about the Brady Bunch. The sitcom was thriving in syndication and remained dear to his heart and wallet. Schwartz vowed to bring America's favourite family back to television again, this time on his terms. After the break, Carol Brady goes into therapy and later the sordid mother and son secret. The Brady curse was taking effect. Acting work for anyone involved in the show was becoming harder and harder to find. For Brady's, it seemed you could run, but you couldn't hide. And while we're talking cliches, here's another. If you can't beat 'em, join 'em. Maybe the only way to be a successful ex-Brady was to embrace Bradydom.
Me too. I'm really looking forward to Saturday night, Dad. I hate to say goodbye too. Bye.
Pretty blonde Maureen McCormack was one of the most popular Bradys. Her role as Marcia was a hit with the girls who wanted to look like her and boys who wanted to go out with her. But McCormack, like many of her co-stars, had trouble making a living from her fame. In the late 70s, she appeared in a string of low-rent movies such as Skate Town USA and Moonshine Country Express. To break out of the Marcia Brady role, 24-year-old McCormack took on the role of a cocktail waitress in the 1981 low-budget movie Texas Lightning.
You better get out of here.
Why, I ain't done nothing. Will you kiss me?
Not surprisingly, the movie did little to further her acting career. In need of work, she agreed to reprise her role as Marcia Brady in the television movie, The Brady Girls Get Married. The project was the brainchild of, guess who? Sherwood Schwartz, who for years had wanted a cast reunion. In 1981, Schwartz got the chance. The story featured the dual wedding ceremonies of sisters Marcia and Jan, but there was a condition. The telemovie could only go ahead if Schwartz brought back the original cast, including Robert Reed. But this wasn't easy, since Schwartz and Reed fought like pit bulls throughout the Brady Bunch. Amazingly, Reed agreed to have a go.
I think I can say that we're as close as any cast could be. First of all, we were playing a family at the time when the kids were kids, and we spent 5 years at it, watched them grow. We spent more time together than we did with our own families, and we liked each other.
Even Eve Plum, who had wisely shunned the Brady Bunch Variety Hour, agreed to appear in the movie.
They managed to come up with some money. And you know, it's like you say no and they keep adding money. And it's not like it's $1 million, billion, but at the time, when you're not doing anything and somebody calls up and says, would you do this for this money? You know? it gets hard to say no.
The Brady Girls Get Married was a ratings winner, and the network immediately ordered a spin-off series called The Brady Brides. The half-hour sitcom featured Marcia, Jan, and the new husbands all sharing a house, with Florence Henderson resuscitating her role as the mother, Carol. The show premiered in February of 1981. Jerry Hauser played Marcia's husband, Wally.
So the premise of The Brady Brides was that neither could afford a house because it's too expensive, so the two couples move in together. Marcia and Wally are kind of wild and free and fun and sleep in the nude, and Jan and Philip are kind of uptight and straight, and the wild, wacky problems that happen from there.